having severe laryngitis, so if my voice cracks, don't hold it against me. Fortunately, I'm not one of the people reading tonight. This is the third in a series of poetry music improvs that we're holding at the Waldron Arts Center. If you look in the back of your program, you'll notice that we have four or five more scheduled, including social, political, and environmental poetry next month, so some of you might want to keep that in mind. Tonight, we're going to be featuring African-American poetry and writing, a lot of blues, some jazz, and some other stuff. We have three people from the IU Theater and Afro-American Studies departments who are here to read tonight: Renee Simmons, Stephanie Anderson, and Michael Grant. The first reader is going to be Renee Simmons, and due to the condition of my voice, I'm going to let her introduce the piece.
Tonight I'll be reading to you two poems. I'll just go ahead and introduce both of them since they come right after each other. First one is called Ma Rainey by Sterling Brown. The second one is called Dream Boogie by Langston Hughes. I hope you enjoy them. When Ma Rainey comes to town, folks from any place, miles around, from Cape Girardeau to Poplar Bluff, flocks to hear Ma do her stuff. Comes flivvering in, or riding mules, or packed in trains, picnicking fools. That's what it's like for miles on down to New Orleans Delta and Mobile Town, when Ma hits anywheres around. They comes in to hear Ma Rainey from the Little River settlements, from the black bottom cornrows, and from the lumber camps. They stumble in the hall, a laughing and a cackling, cheering like roaring water, like wind in river swamps. And some jokers keep their laughter a-going in the crowded aisles, and some folks sits there with their aches and miseries. Tima comes out before, a smile and a gold tooth smile. And long boy ripples minors on them black and yellow keys. Rainey, sing your song. Now you's back where you belong. Get way inside us. Keep us strong. Oh, Ma Rainey, little and low, sing us about the hard luck round your door. Sing us about the lonesome road we must go. To a fella, and the fella say, she just catch hold of us that kind of way. She sang backwater blues one day. It rained for days, and the sky was dark as night. Trouble taken in the lowlands at night. Thundered and lightning and storms begin to roll. Thousands of people ain't got no place to go. Then I went up and stood on some high old lonesome hill and looked down on the place where I used to live. And the folks, they naturally bowed their heads and cried, bowed their heavy heads, shut their mouths up tight and cried. And Ma left the stage, and some folks followed her outside. There wasn't much that fella could say. She just gets a hold of us that kind of way. Rumble of a dream deferred. Listen closely. You'll hear their feet beating out a... You think it's a happy beat? Listen to it closely. Ain't you heard? Something underneath like a... What did I say? Sure I'm happy. Take it away. Re-bop-be-bop-mop. Re-bop-be-bop-mop. Yeah.
And now we're going to have Stephanie Anderson is going to come up and read. This piece is entitled, the poem is entitled January Afternoon with Billie Holiday. It's the only poem in the whole program that was not written by an African-American. She's actually German. But it's about Billie Holiday, and we just took a little poetic license on this one. I'd like to introduce Stephanie Anderson.
You'll have to forgive me, I didn't place my first poem, which comes from the Jazz Poetry Anthology book, in here. January Afternoon by Billie Holiday. Shifts as if it were light, from chalk to parchment, to oil. I think of the sun this morning, how many knives were flashed through black compliant trees. Now she has aged it with her singing, turned it to milk thinned with water. A poor people's son, enough knowledge to go around. I want to dance, to bend, as gradually as a flower. Release a ball in slow motion to follow in the marvelous path of yet an unfolding jet streak, love's expansive finger across the cheek of the sky, heaven. I'm in heaven. The foolish old songs were right. The heart does actually ache from trying to push beyond itself, this room, the world. All that can be imagined, space is not enough space for its sudden immensity. I am not what you think. This is not what I wanted. Desire has no object. It simply happens, rises and floats. Lighter than air, but she knows that. Her voice scrapes against the innocent words of the song, and tomorrow is something she remembers. The second piece that I will be reading is entitled Easy Living, which is a song by Billie Holiday.
When nothing in life but you.
Next thing on the program is a poem by Jake Webster, if he's here. Yeah, are you ready, Jake? Okay. Jake is a sculptor and a poet, and he originally wasn't on the program, but we put him on in the last few days. Well, we can live with that.
Okay. Let me read one poem, and then I bring some sculptures in and let y'all see what I do, because sometimes it's kind of difficult when you're a sculptor and you happen to write notes to yourself. Some folks call it poetry. but it's always nice. And I bring all these little papers in because I get real nervous, but by the time I stop shuffling the papers, I'm okay. Okay, so this is really my prop. And now, I have two pieces of sculpture, both of a little over 6 feet tall, that I will slip in and sort of give you a quick view of what I do. But it's sort of good not to see the sculpture and listen, me reading it to you. And the poem that I would like to read, the title of it is Feeling. And it's about making sculpture, but it's also about, listening. She eased her breast out from under her thin nightgown. She gentle eased her soft nipple into my mouth. A feeling, a wonderful feeling, nothing but a feeling. She takes her soft hands and caresses me all over and hold me close to her to ensure my comfort. A feeling, a wonderful feeling, nothing but a feeling. She sings sweet melodies in my ear that soothes me all over. She rocks me on her shoulder to let me know that she's always near. A feeling, a wonderful feeling. She pulls the covers back on her neatly dressed bed. She walks over and dims the light, and the mood is set. A feeling, a wonderful feeling, nothing but a feeling. A feeling, a wonderful feeling, nothing but a feeling. There is no feeling like this feeling when a mother is feeding her baby at bedtime. And that sort of gives you a clue to my sculpture. You see these things, and folks like to think bad, but they are not bad. I just do good things. And the last poem that I would like to share with you is about an experience I had. We talks about the homeless, and we see homelessness. But in America, we have two things happening at once that we all associate with homelessness. We have folks that's genuine homelessness. And then we have folk out in the streets that are really sick people that has been turned out of institutions. And they're without proper medication, they're without proper medical assistance. And we consider these people homeless too, but their first priority should be getting medical assistance and then maybe finding some place to live. So we have two problems that we like to group into one. But my rude awakening to the homelessness is finding a homeless person on 42nd Street. Now, what's so unusual about that? As big as New York, I think 12 million people, 18 million people in the course of a day in and out of New York. So what's so bad about finding a homeless person on 42nd Street, which is the heart of New York? It's I know that you are there. Your face I have seen many times. I've heard the jingle from your cup, for I have moved my body to the rhythm. Somehow, I thought you were so far away until I found myself walking wide to keep from stepping on you, until I found myself quickly turning right or left to keep from touching you. I never given you a second thought because you are everywhere with your cardboard boxes, plastic bags, and overcoats. Even when it's 90 degrees, pushing carts and pulling baskets filled with only God knows what. All time of day, all time of night, in subway station, on subway train, on street corners, in front of office buildings, in doorways of bank buildings, and even in front of church buildings. Oh God. To my dismay, to my surprise, to my shock, finding a homeless person on 42nd Street, dead, dead, dead. And this was my crude awakening, a rude awakening. The first night that the temperature dropped, a guy that I had been seeing all summer froze to death. And when I ran out of the building, because in New York you stop thinking after a while and you just move, you just act. And when I ran out of the building, there was this guy. And then all of a sudden, I had to step over him to get out of the building. And what a rude awakening, you know, for this social disease that we have plague in America. And we all like to think it's somebody else's problem. You know, in Bloomington, we don't see it as much. But every now and then, it touches us. And we see it here. These are the things I sculpt. These are the things I paint. These are the things I talk about. And these are the things that I like to make kids aware of. Some great writer, some great poet once said, a man's real possession is his memory. And nothing else is he's rich, and nothing else is he's poor. So we have to learn and touch as we go in this life. Thank you, and I will bring this sculpture in. Thank you.
Jake Webster. Jake, could you bring the sculpture in at intermission, and we'll have it set up for the second set. I spent half my life in New York City, lived there for 17 years, both in Brooklyn and Manhattan, and I hadn't been there for a long time, and I went back 2 or 3 years ago, and when I lived there, there were homeless people sleeping on the Bowery and in 42nd Street and in Times Square, but now I notice they got homeless people sleeping on Park Avenue and in bank doorways and places where the rich people live, so maybe that's going to make something change, I don't know. Jake reminded me of that. The next piece is called No Images. It's going to be read by Renee Simmons.
She does not know her beauty. She thinks her brown body has no glory. But if she could dance naked under palm trees and see her image in the river, she would know. But there are no palm trees on the street. And dishwater gives back no images. Dishwater gives back no images. Gives back no images. No images. The next piece I'll be reading is called No More Love Poems, Number 1, by Intozake Shange. It's taken from a play entitled, a choreo drama entitled, For Colored Girls Who Have Considered Suicide When the Rainbow Is Enough. Ever since I realized there was something called a colored girl, an evil woman, a bitch, or a nag, I've been trying not to be that and leave bitterness in somebody else's cup, to come to someone to love me without deep and nasty smelling skull from lie or being left screaming in the street full of lunatics whispering, slut, bitch, bitch, get out of here with all of that. I didn't have any of that for you. I brought you what joy I found. And I found joy. Honest fingers round my face with dead musicians on 78s from Cuba, or live musicians on $5 LPs from Chicago, where I've never been. And I was loved by Willie Colon and Arsenio Rodriguez, especially because I could make the music loud. So there is no me but the dance. And where I can dance like that, there's nothing can hurt me. But I get tired and have to come off of the floor. And then there's that woman that hurt you, that you left 3 or 4 times and just went on back after you put my heart on the bottom of your shoe. You just walked on back to where you hurt. And I didn't have nothing. So I went to where somebody had something for me. But it wasn't you. And I was on the way back from her house in the bottom of your shoe. So this is not a love poem. Because there are only memorial albums available. And even Charlie Mingus desperately wanted to be a pimp. And I won't be able to see Eddie Palmieri for months. So this is a requiem for myself. Because I have died in a real way. Not with aqua coffins or doo-wop Cadillacs that I used to joke about when I was messing around. But a real dead loving is here for you now. because I don't know anymore. I don't know how to avoid my own face wet with my own tears. And I convinced myself that colored girls had no right to sorrow. And I lived and I loved that way, and I kept sorrow on the curb, allegedly for you. But I know I did it for myself. I couldn't stand it. I couldn't stand being sorry and colored at the same time. It's so redundant in the modern world.
The last poem in the first part of the program is called Reflections After the June 12th March for Disarmament by Sonia Sanchez, who's a really fine poet, and it's going to be read by Stephanie Anderson, and we're going to make some very strange sounds in the background, I hope.
Reflections After the June 12th March for Disarmament. I have come to you tonight out of the depths of slavery, from white hands peeling black skins over America. I have come out to you from Reconstruction eyes that closed on black humanity, that reduced black hope to the dark huts of America. I have come to you from the lynching years, the exploitation of black men and women by a country that allowed the swinging of strange fruits from southern trees. I have come to you tonight through the Delaney years, the Du Bois years, the B.T. Washington years, the Robeson years, the Garvey years, the Depression years, the you can't eat or sit or live, just die here years. The civil rights years, the black power years, the black nationalist years, the affirmative action years, the liberal years, the neoconservative years. I have come to say that those years were not in vain. The ghosts of our ancestors searching this American dust for rest were not in vain. Black women walking their lives in clots were not in vain. The years walked sideways in a forsaken land were not in vain. I have come to you tonight as an equal, as a comrade, as a black woman walking down a corridor of tears, walking neither left nor to the right, pulling my history with bruised heels, beckoning to the illusion of America, daring you to look me in the eyes, to see the faces, the exploitation of a people because of skin pigmentation. Thank you. I have come to you tonight because no people have been asked to be modern-day people with the history of slavery. And still we walk, and still we talk, and still we plan, and still we hope, and still we sing. I have come to you tonight because there are inhumanitarians in the world. They are not new. They are old. They go back into history. They were called explorers, soldiers, mercenaries, imperialists, missionaries, adventurers. But they looked at the world for what it would give up to them, and they violated the land and the people. They looked at the land and sectioned it up for private ownership. They looked at the people and decided how to manipulate them through fear and ignorance. They looked at the gold and began to hoard and worship it. I have come to you because it is time for all of us to purge capitalism from our dream, to purge materialism from our eyes, from the planet Earth, to deliver the Earth again into the hands of humanitarians. I have come to you tonight not just for the stoppage of nuclear proliferation, nuclear plants, nuclear bombs, nuclear waste, but to stop the proliferation of nuclear mines, of nuclear generals, of nuclear presidents, of nuclear scientists who spread human and nuclear waste over the world. I come to you because the world needs to be saved for the future generations, who must return the earth to peace, who will not be startled by a man's, woman's skin color. I come to you because the world needs sanity now. Needs men and women who will not work to produce nuclear weapons, who will give up their need for excess wealth and learn how to share the world's resources, who will never again, as scientists, invent again just for the sake of inventing. I come to you because we need to turn our eyes to the beauty of this planet, to the bright green laughter of trees, to the beautiful human animals waiting and wanting to smile their unprostituted smiles. I have come to you to talk about our inexperience at living as human beings. Through death marches and camps, through middle passages and slavery, and thundering countries raining hungry faces. I am here to move against leaving our shadows implanted on the earth, while our bodies disintegrate in nuclear lightning. I am here between the voices of our ancestors and the noise of the planet, between the surprise of death and life. I am here because I shall not give the earth up to non-dreamers and earth molesters. I am here to say to you, my body is full of veins, like the bombs waiting to burst with blood. We must learn to suckle life, not bombs and rhetoric, rising up in a red, white, and blue patriotism. I am here, and my breath, our breaths, must thunder across this land, arousing new breaths, new life, new people who will live in peace and honor. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to take a short break now, and then we're going to come back for the second half, which includes a lengthy reading from the autobiography of Malcolm X.
Okay, good evening. The first piece I'll be reading is entitled Le Sporting Club de Monte Carlo by James Baldwin, and it's dedicated to Lena Horne. The lady is a tramp, a camp, a lamp. The lady is a sight, a mite, a light. The lady devastated an alley or two, reverberated through the valley which leads me to you. The lady is the apple of God's eye. He's cool enough about it, but he tends to strut a little when she passes by. The lady is a wonder, daughter of the thunder, smash in cages, legislating rages, with a voice of the ages. Singing us through. The next piece is entitled Morning After. I had a dream last night. Thought I was in hell. I dreamt last night, I thought I was in hell. Woke up, looked around me. Oh, babe, your mouth was open like a well. I said, baby, please don't snore so loud. Baby, please don't snore so loud. You're just a little bit of a woman, but you sound like a great big crowd.
The next poem is going to be a cappella, as they say in the trade, no music. It's a poem by Sonia Sanchez, and it's going to be read by Stephanie Anderson. Here she is, Stephanie Anderson.
It's amazing, admiring the art upstairs. This is entitled Story. I'm so embarrassed. And you're all so polite with a good sense of humor. This is entitled Story by Sonia Sanchez. In medias res, there came a man into the city. He wore a jackdaw face and loved the glittering town. I cannot say why he chose me. I was the city's device, the city's kept secret. Yet he lifted me until I had enough
until I had enough passion to please all displeasure. Go ahead and laugh. Yet he lifted me until I had a passion to please all displeasures. Each day he said, "Oh, my child, the world has moved away from love. The earth has moved away from worship. I am destined to end their exile." And he returned me to the mainland, dressed in white. I was in unity. Soon, oh soon, I would be worthy. Because he was good with his hands, he became a technician, where mathematical abstractions were operable. Thus, he caressed two levers that could level three generations of Russians resting in their squares. Each day he cried, "When will they understand the errors of their ways? When will they touch the Godhead and leave the verses of the rock?" And I was dressed in blue, blue of the Savior sky. Soon, oh soon, I would be worthy. There are many men, and there are many cities rooted. There are few men, there are few cities afraid. There are cities crowded with Christs invisible. There are men crystal with echoes indifferent. There are many cities. There are men in the cities, empty. There are few cities. There are few men worthy. Soon, oh soon, I would be worthy. Ring around the atmosphere, a pocket full of chains. Kerboom, kerboom, we have no pains.
As we said before, the poem I'm reading is Malcolm, Semper Malcolm, and it's a poem by Archie Shepp, who's a musician also. A song is not what it seems. A tune, perhaps. Bird whistled while even America listened. We play, but we're not always down. We're murdered in ample theaters, on the podium of the Autobahn, the Earl. Philadelphia, 1945. Malcolm, my people, dear God, Malcolm. Thank you.
first piece is called Black Sister by Katie Kumba. And the second piece I'll be doing is Still I Rise by Maya Angelou. Black skin against green, beautiful sister, hair a mess. Don't you know you don't need that wig? You are so beautiful, ancient African queen. Black sister, your bold features, your strong limbs, your feet that stomp sand into deserts, Sahara, your sturdiness. But oh, why not more sureness to enhance your blackness? Black skin against green, touches of red, black. Oh, beautiful sister, queen of the Nile, beautiful ancient African queen, black sister. Rich rivers run through your veins, your teeth of ivory, your eyes, your smile. Oh, beautiful sister, think. Let's think about the empires, the richness. You must have more sureness and think more about your blackness. And boy, you have now become a man. So, brother, proclaim the beauty that you see in your beautiful black sister. You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still, like dust, I'll rise. Does my sassiness upset you? Why are you beset with gloom? 'Cause I walk like I got oil wells pumping in my living room. Just like moons and like suns, like the certainty of tides, just like hope springing high, still I rise. Did you want to see me broken? Bowed head and lowered eyes, shoulders falling down like teardrops, weakened by my soulful cries. Does my haughtiness offend you? Don't you take it awful hard, 'cause I laugh like I got gold mines digging in my own backyard. You may shoot me with your words. You may cut me with your eyes. You may kill me with your hatefulness, but still, like air, I'll rise. Does my sexiness upset you? Does it come as any surprise that I dance like I got diamonds between the meeting of my thighs? Out of the huts of history's shame, I rise. Up from the past that's rooted in pain, I rise. I am a black ocean, leaping and wide, welling and swelling till I bear the tide, leaving behind the nights of terror and fear. I rise into a daybreak that's wondrously clear. I rise, bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave. I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise.
This piece is entitled This Poem, and it's by a Jamaican poet and group called Mutabruku. This poem will speak of the wretched seas that wash ships to these shores, of mothers crying for their young swallowed up by the sea. This poem will say nothing new. This poem will speak of time, time unlimited, time undefined. This poem shall call names, names like Namumba, Kenyatta, Ankuno, Appleton, Markham, Garvey, Haile Selassie. This poem is vexed about apartheid, racism, fascism, the Ku Klux Klan, riots in Brixton, Atlanta, Jim Jones. This poem is revolting against first world, second world, third world divisions, man-made decisions. This poem is like all the rest. This poem will not be among great literary works. It will not be recited by poetry enthusiasts. It will not be quoted by politicians or men of religion. This poem is knives, bombs, guns, blood, fire, blazing for freedom. Yes, this poem is a drum. Ashanti, Ma, Ibu, Yoruba, Naibingi warriors, Yohuru, 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 Soweto, Naribia, Yohuru, Yohuru, Africa. This poem will not change things. This poem needs to be changed. This poem is the rebirth of a people, arising, awaking, understanding. This poem will continue even when poets have stopped writing. This poem shall survive you, me. It shall linger in history, in time, in your mind, forever. This poem is time. Only time will tell. This poem is still not written. This poem has no point. This poem is a part of the story, his story, her story, our story. The story still untold. This poem is now ringing, talking, irritating, making you want to stop it. But this poem will not be stopped. This poem is long, cannot be short. This poem cannot be tamed, cannot be blamed. The story is still not told about this poem. This poem is old, new. This poem was copied from your Bible, your prayer books, Playboy magazine, the New York Times, Reader Digest, the CIA files, the KGB files. This poem is no secret. This poem shall be called boring, stupid, senseless. This poem is watching you trying to make sense of this poem. This poem is messing up your brains, making you want to stop it. But you can't stop listening to this poem. You need to know what will be said next in this poem. This poem will disappoint you, because this poem is to be continued in your mind. This next piece, poetry, poets of this century, this age, is in a form called rap music. A lot of the poetry that you'll hear is behind backbeats, drums, guitars, music, but it's poetry nonetheless. This poet is Ice-T, and the title is Prepared to Die. Watch me flip and rip on the freedom tip. excuse me. Watch me frip and rip on the freedom tip. See the point of the ice pick. I stand tall when my brothers still choose to crawl. Black power. It's an effect, y'all. But still you don't understand. You're still a slave to the man. Prepare for revolution. Some suckers say we're free. I gotta disagree. Half my posse's in the penitentiary. So I'ma drop and kick this science with defiance. Because I have no alliance for those suckers that choose to act black when they are black. Get out my face with that. You better ease back. Because Mandela said 27 hard ones. Not in a windowed room, but in a barred one. While his wife had tears in her eyes, the man's a hero. He needs a Nobel Prize, but that'll never happen, so I'm gonna keep rapping. Feed my brother's brains of entrapment. To silence the ice, they'll have to put a bullet in me. But I'm prepared to die, and Mandela's free. And my last piece is entitled SOS. By Amira Baraka. Calling all black people, calling all black people, man, woman, child, wherever you are. Calling you urgent, come in. Black people, come in wherever you are. Urgent, calling you. Calling all black people, calling all black people. Come on in, black people. Come on in.
Michael Grant. The last piece for the evening is a lengthy excerpt from the autobiography of Malcolm X. It's going to be read by Stephanie Anderson, and it's going to be accompanied by a tape that was used in the movie that just came out. Stephanie Anderson.
How many of you have read the autobiography of Malcolm X? How many of you have seen the movie? Well, I suggest those of you who have not do see it. Spike has outdone himself. But more than that, Malcolm is a beautiful man, and that is conveyed in the movie. And that was what was most important to me, to see that he did justice. If in any way you can do justice to Malcolm X within a 3-hour and 20-minute movie. My thinking had been opened up wide in Mecca. In the long letters I wrote to friends, I tried to convey to them my new insights into the American black man's struggle and his problem, as well as the depths of my search for truth and justice. I've had enough of someone else's propaganda, I had written to these friends. I'm for truth, no matter who tells it. I'm for justice, no matter who it is for or against. I'm a human being first and foremost, and as such, I'm for whoever and whatever benefits humanity as a whole. Largely, the American white man's press refused to convey that I was now attempting to teach Negroes a new direction. With the 1964 long, hot summer steadily producing new incidents, I was constantly accused of stirring up Negroes. Every time I had another radio or television microphone at my mouth, when I was asked about stirring up Negroes or inciting violence, I'd get hot. It takes no one to stir up the sociological dynamite that stems from the unemployment, bad housing, and inferior education already in the ghettos. This explosively criminal condition has existed for so long. It needs no fuse. It fuses itself. It spontaneously combusts within itself. It takes no one to stir up. Okay, I've read that. They called me the angriest Negro in America. I wouldn't deny that charge. I spoke exactly as I felt. I believe in anger. The Bible says there is a time for anger. They called me a teacher, a fomenter of violence. I would say point blank, that is a lie. I'm not for wanton violence, I'm for justice. I feel that if white people were attacked by Negroes, if the forces of law prove unable or inadequate or reluctant to protect those whites from those Negroes, then those white people should protect and defend themselves from those Negroes using arms if necessary. And I feel that when the law fails to protect Negroes from whites' attack, then those Negroes should use arms if necessary to defend themselves. Malcolm X advocates armed Negroes. What was wrong with that? I'll tell you what was wrong. I was a black man talking about physical defense against a white man. The white man can lynch, burn, and bomb and beat Negroes. That's all right. Have patience. The customs are entrenched. Things are getting better. Well, I believe it's a crime for anyone who is being brutalized to continue to accept that brutality without doing something to defend himself. If that's how Christian philosophy is interpreted, if that's what Gandhian philosophy teaches, well then, I would call them criminal philosophies. I tried in every speech I made to clarify my new position regarding white people. I don't speak against the sincere, well-meaning, good white people. I have learned that there are some. I have learned that not all white people are racist. I'm speaking against, and my fight is against, the white racists. I firmly believe that Negroes have the right to fight against these racists by any means that are necessary. But the white reporters kept wanting me linked with that word, violence. I doubt if I had one interview without having to deal with that accusation. I am for violence if nonviolence means we continue postponing a solution to the American black man's problem just to avoid violence. I don't go for nonviolence if it also means a delayed solution. To me, delayed solution is a non-solution. Or I'll say it another way. If it must take violence to get the black man his human rights in this country, I'm for violence. Exactly as you know the Irish, the Poles, or Jews would be if they were flagrantly discriminated against. I am just as they would be in that case. And they would be for violence, no matter what the consequences, no matter who was hurt by the violence. When the white man came into this country, he certainly wasn't demonstrating any nonviolence. In fact, the very man whose name symbolizes nonviolence here today has stated, "Our nation was born in genocide when it embraced the doctrine that the original American, the Indian, was an inferior race. Even before there were large numbers of Negroes on our shores, the scar of racial hatred had already disfigured colonial society. From the 16th century forward, blood flowed in battles over racial supremacy. We are perhaps the only nation which tried as a matter of national policy to wipe out its indigenous population. Moreover, we elevated that tragic experience into a noble crusade. Indeed, even today we have not permitted ourselves to reject or to feel remorse for this shameful episode. Our literature, our films, our drama, our folklore, all exalted. Our children are still taught to respect the violence which reduced a red-skinned people of an earlier culture into a few fragmented groups herded into impoverished reservations. Peaceful coexistence, that's another one the white man has always been quick to cry. Fine, but what we have been through, but what have the deeds of the white man been? During his entire advance through history, he has been waving the banner of Christianity and carrying in his other hand the sword and the flintlock. You can go right back to the very beginning of Christianity, Catholicism, the genesis of Christianity as we know it to be presently constituted, with its hierarchy, was conceived in Africa by those whom the Christian church calls the Desert Fathers. The Christian church became infected with racism when it entered white Europe. The Christian church returned to Africa under the banner of the cross, conquering, killing, exploiting, pillaging, raping, bullying, beating, and teaching white supremacy. This is how the white man thrust himself into the position of leadership of the world, through the use of naked physical power, and he was totally inadequate spiritually. Mankind's history has proved from one era to another that the true criterion of leadership is spiritual. Men are attracted by spirit, by power, men are forced. Love is engendered by spirit.
I'd like to have a hand for everybody who took part in this program. First of all, Renee Simmons, would you come up and take a bow? Stephanie Anderson. Michael Grant. Craig Brenner on piano. His son Eli on drums, probably the only father and son piano and drum team in town. Dave Biller on guitar. Kyle Kloss on trumpet, John Huber on bass, and myself, I'm Steve Gardner.